他是世上极少数既做过总理也当了总统的人。
Well, it feels good to be in this job. It's a huge challenge.
在南美洲秘鲁利马，11月将有大事发生。
Try to define how the whole Asia Pacific and Latin American area.Is going to work together in trade.
两洋铁路又进展如何？专访秘鲁共和国总统佩德罗、巴勃罗、库琴斯基。
大家好，欢迎收看《风云对话》，我是小田。那今天我们这期节目要采访的嘉宾是秘鲁的新总统，也是老总统库琴斯基。说他是新总统，因为他刚刚出任总统才两个月；说他是老总统呢，因为就在我们的十一小长假期间，库琴斯基总统已经迎来了他的78岁生日。那是什么能让他在77岁的时候参加总统竞选，依然赢得国民的信任？又是什么让他打破传统惯例，新总统上任首个外访国不是选择美国，而是大洋彼岸的中国？那我们一起来看一看这位新上任的老总统，听一听他是否为他的国家发展带来了新的思路，为即将在利马举行的 APEC 会议打开了新的局面。
Good morning, President PPK. Thank you for having us this morning.
I'm happy to be here.
And you see, not so many people in the world, men or women, have been both the prime minister and the president of a country, and you have. How does it feel?
Well, it feels good to be
of course,
in this
good.
Job. It's a huge challenge. I'm the first finance minister in the history of Peru to be president. Oh.I was finance minister 10-15 years ago, and in Peru we also have the post of prime minister, which, like in China or Russia or France, is the person underneath the president. So I had that experience also.
佩德罗·巴勃罗·库琴斯基1938年10月3日出生于秘鲁首都利马。他毕业于牛津大学政治、哲学和经济学专业，后又获得普林斯顿大学公共管理学硕士学位。有了世界名校光环的加持，库琴斯基的职业生涯开始风生水起。1961年，他进入世界银行工作，成为专门研究中美洲和加勒比地区的经济学家。回到秘鲁后，担任秘鲁能源与矿产部长、经济与财政部长。2005年至2006年，出任秘鲁总理。2016年6月。库琴斯基以微弱的优势战胜秘鲁前总统彭森的女儿，人民力量党候选人彭森庆子。7月，库琴斯基宣誓就职，出任新一届秘鲁总统。
You see, when I read your biography, I was totally amazed, because you graduate from Oxford University, Princeton University, and then you worked with the World Bank, the IMF, and then you became at a very young age the energy minister of your country.
Right.
And then you went in exile for a few years, and then you went back to your country to resume your political career, and now you're the president.
Right.
What makes it all possible? I mean, to achieve so many things in such a swift
well,
and outstanding
in many years,
manner.
I have worked for...over 55 years, and it's true, I started at the World Bank, and then I was the number two in the Reserve Bank, the central bank. It's like the People's Bank here in China. And then we had a military government, and I left and returned 11 years later as energy minister.So I have spent quite a lot of my time outside Peru, but I returned in the late 90s to Peru and worked with Alejandro Toledo, who became president. And we had a very good, successful government that continues in various incarnations to.
But you see, as you said, that you spent quite many years outside of Peru. So for a politician, what enables you to understand your country well enough to be a
well,
president?
Well, as a young man, I worked in the interior of Peru, in the Sierra, in the mountains, on a farm. As a little kid, I was brought up in Iquitos, which is in the Amazon, in Puno, which is one of the highest cities up in the world at 4,000 meters. Actually, we were at 5,000 meters in a special village that my father was studying. He was a doctor and an anthropologist and was very interested in altitude medicine, social medicine, which is how poverty and migration affect health. Mm-hmm. And he was here in China in the 20s for I don't know how many years, maybe 2-3 years, on a medical mission from Germany that began in Kyrgyzstan and came to China to look at various diseases, including yellow fever. Mm-hmm. And he worked also in Brazil in the late 20s. Developing the vaccine for yellow fever.
Yeah, a very well-traveled father.
And did you right, and I am well-traveled too in different circles. No,
that's
true. I've worked in Washington at the World Bank, in New York on Wall Street. I've been in various incarnations.
Yeah, that's true. So in the past, you have also met the older Chinese leadership generations.
Right. In the 80s, I was here several times helping Dr. Hammer develop a big coal mine in Shaanxi, Inner Mongolia. And we met Deng Xiaoping in the Great Hall of the People 2 or 3 times. And then I came back later and met Jiang Zemin. Also, I think it was in his office, actually. Mm. So these are circumstantial meetings, but we had pretty good conversation.
9月13日，中国国家主席习近平与秘鲁总统库琴斯基举行会谈，两国元首一致认为中秘关系重要且内涵丰富。近十年来，南美洲国家巴西、智利、秘鲁等国对华出口贸易增长了10倍。为了更深入地开展合作，2014年7月，习近平出访拉美时，中国、巴西、秘鲁三国就开展连接大西洋和太平洋的两洋铁路合作共同发表声明，未来将开展包括规划、设计、建设、运营在内的整体合作。
So at this moment, China, Peru, and Brazil, they are talking about the possibility of building a railway across the Latin America continent, connecting the two biggest oceans on the planet. How did it go?
Well, I am very interested in a train that is more modest than that, which will connect the metropolitan area of Lima from north to south. It's about 400 kilometers long. Lima today has 11 million people, but the metropolitan area could in some years have 20 million people. So we need to think ahead. The Trans-Amazonic Railway is an interesting idea, but it has to be studied. And its costs are quite high, and we have to measure the costs.
How is it going to be funded, right?
Well, I don't know how it's going to be financed because I have various priorities that I think are more immediate for Peru. Yeah,
what are your priorities?
My priorities are, first of all, to have water and public health in every village and town in Peru. That's number one. We still have 1/3 of the population with no potable water, running water in their house. We need to clean up our sewerage and garbage system, which is polluting rivers, lakes, the ocean. So that's the first. The second priority is to get our school system modernized. We have about 60,000 public schools that need a lot of things. They need solar panels, they need Wi-Fi, they need bathrooms, they need proper classrooms, they need better paid teachers. That is a very big priority. Mm-hmm. Our public health system needs to be modernized. We still have undernourishment, anemia, So that is a big, big subject.
It sounds like you have a very clear blueprint in your mind.
I think I do.
Construction, yes. But the reality is that your party does not have the majority of seats in your Congress.
Well, that is true and not true. Because Peru has a presidential system, and I won the election, even though by a small margin. And so far, we have good relations with the Congress. They approved our cabinet by 121 votes with only 2 votes against. They have approved our economic plan. Which is a very positive step.
在今年的总统大选中，库琴斯基代表为了变革秘鲁人党获得胜利，而他的政党只赢得了议会共130个席位中的13席。最大反对党由藤森庆子领导的人民力量党却占有73席。有评论说，库琴斯基有可能面临来自国内藤森主义的牵制和对抗。在竞选时期，库琴斯基誓言改善治安，承诺减税，支持小型企业发展基础设施建设。藤森庆子也已公开表示不会支持库琴斯基的经济政策。
And now the Congress is looking at some tax measures that we want to take that are contrary to most countries, lowering taxes rather than raising them, in order to facilitate the small businesses that are the majority of businesses in Peru being part of the credit system, which today they're not, no.
秘鲁离我们有多远？若是民航客机能够不间断飞行，从相距16650公里的两个首都北京飞到利马需要24个小时。这个遥远的南太平洋国家以矿产和农业著称，加工制造业十分落后。走在利马的大街小巷，大多数工业消费品都源自进口，因为中国已是秘鲁的第一大贸易伙伴，中国制造在秘鲁也随处可见。
So there are already some Chinese companies working, operating in Peru.
Oh, there are big Chinese companies. China Minmetals has a huge mine in the south of Peru called Las Bambas. Mm-hmm. It's one of the biggest copper mines in the world. Started producing last year. And Chinalco, China Aluminum Company, has a very large mine also in mm-hmm. the center of Peru.And we have other Chinese activities.
How are they welcomed by the indigenous?
Well, there are always a few people who are opposed to mining all over the world. Nobody wants a giant quarry next to their house, no. So there's nothing new about that. There are some foundations and NGOs.That stimulate the opposition to the mines. But the reality is most mines in Peru are way up in the Andes, 4,000 or 5,000 meters above sea level, where there are very few people. Mm-hmm. The issue is not so much the people as the water sources.Because the water comes obviously from the high Andes. Mm. And so there are very often disputes about the water and access to the water. That's the real issue.
现在在秘鲁没有用上自来水的人还有1000万之多。这占秘鲁整个人口数量的1/3。针对社会问题进行改革是政府正面临的重要挑战之一。库琴斯基表示秘鲁正在放开基础设施的投资，还鼓励推进新的产品出口，增加就业来源。他将自己比喻为秘鲁最积极推崇贸易开放的先导者。 他说，秘鲁的平均关税非常低，乃至在拉美国家中最低，这为秘鲁的对外贸易发展提供了有利条件。
So you advocate the free trade, and you also expressed your concerns over Donald Trump's idea of raising the tariffs and banish the free trade agreement.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I'm not part of the U.S. election. I have nothing to do there. But my view is that several people are making the wrong analysis of what the problem is, both in Europe and the U.S., especially in Europe, where the idea is that free trade is eliminating jobs. No, but that's not true. What is eliminating jobs is robotics. No.Robot-driven factories because of high labor costs in some countries. That wouldn't be the case, for example, in Peru, where we have quite a lot of industry. So to say that immigration is ruining the job market in the U.S. is simply not true.Mexican, Central American immigration to the U.S., including a few Peruvians, Colombians, has lowered the average age, has helped the social security system finance itself. So it's been basically positive. No?
Yeah, but let's take assumption. Let's say if Donald Trump becomes the president of America and he does what he says.What would you mean to America?
Well, he's not going to build any wall. That's a totally ridiculous idea. No.
And he's going to ask the Mexicans to pay for that.
No, no, no. The Mexicans have made a huge contribution to the U.S. economy. And actually, Mexican immigration into the U.S. in the last few years has reversed. There are more...Mexicans going to Mexico from the U.S. Than the other way around. So the facts are quite different. No?
Right.
因未知而显得更加神秘，秘鲁就是一个这样的国家。跨过距离的祖国去探索这片土地，好几个曾繁荣一时的文明又悄悄隐去，留下神秘的传说。马丘比丘是秘鲁最引人的景点之一，它保存完好，整个遗址高耸在海拔2350米的山脊之上，俯瞰着乌鲁班巴河谷。这座前哥伦布时期印加帝国的遗迹，2007年被评为世界新七大奇迹之一。
And I understand that Peru would like to boost the tourism among Chinese travelers.
Well, the Chinese people.As incomes rise in China, are one of the biggest tourist groups in the world. No, so we want to attract a new source of tourism. It'll take time to develop, but I think China, if we package this right with other Latin American countries, because nobody's going to go to just one place. Get good airline connections, have the type of hotels that Chinese people like, we can, in a few years, show some results. It'll take time, but I think we can do it in this government.
Yeah, and the Bureau now is working on some special visa policies for Chinese travelers.
Well, we've already approved the change in the visa policies last week, which is very simple.If you have in your passport a Schengen visa or U.S. Canadian visa, then you don't need any visa to go to Peru.
秘鲁是2016年亚太经济合作组织领导人峰会的东道国。今年11月，系列会议将在首都利马举行。这座有500年历史的古城，记载着秘鲁乃至南美洲辛酸悲壮的殖民史。利马还被叫做无雨之都。每年的降雨量仅有10到15毫米，街道上甚至没有一处下水道。
In Lima, there's going to be the APEC soon.
Right.
So what's this the theme about?
This is in the middle of November. I think it'll be a very important meeting to try to define how the whole Asia-Pacific and Latin American area is going to work together in trade. And China has proposed an Asia-Pacific, Latin America free trade area. The U.S. has proposed the TPP, but the TPP does not include China. The Asia-Pacific free trade area does include China.
That is something very interesting to understand why China is not included. And do you think that China should or should not be included?
I used to work in journalism, among other things, and I always said that was what was wrong with the TPP. It excluded the biggest actor. Now, of course, for Peru, we have free trade agreements with China, with Korea, with Japan, with Singapore, with Thailand. We are negotiating with Australia and New Zealand. So in the end, we can work things out for us. But the important thing is to have a one system rather than a lot of different systems.
Mm-hmm. But to understand why China is not included at this point.
Well, because the TPP was a proposal of the U.S. Where people said, the intellectuals and commentators, that China had an exchange rate that favored its exports. That is no longer true, if it ever was, no? And so that was the reason that various entities, including the State Department, proposed the TPP. Now, we checked with the Chinese authorities, and they said, look, I mean, that's up to you, it's not so important. So we're willing to sign the TPP, we already said so. But if the other alternative comes along, maybe that's a better alternative for us. It's certainly better for China, which is our biggest trading partner. So we got to pay attention.
Great. Thank you very much, President. Thank you.
可以说呢，库琴斯基总统有一段相当丰富的职业履历。名校毕业，国际机构任职，年纪轻轻从政，并且官至总理。期间因为政治的风云变幻，还有过一段流亡的经历。我问他是什么可以让他先后涉足这么多领域，而且好像在每个领域都做得不错。他似乎并无心做理论宣讲，没有为年轻人准备任何的鸡汤。他一直在很认真地进行我们的采访对话，很认真地应答采访里的每一个问题。采访外聊天的时候，他说他喜欢旅游，爱好音乐，也喜欢和家人静静地待着，享受阳光。感谢收看本期节目，我们下周见。